Dear students, keeping in continuation with the development of the head and neck, today I am going to tell you about the development of the tongue as well as the thyroid gland in an embryo, and also we will discuss about the congenital anomalies associated with the tongue and thyroid gland development. Now, before I discuss the development of the tongue, let us recollect about what we have learned about the pharyngeal arches. So where does this pharyngeal arches develop? We have already learned about the pharyngeal arches, clefts and pouches. So this pharyngeal arches in an embryo, it develops in the region of the pharyngeal gut. These are the bars of mesenchymal tissue. As you can see in the picture, the brown color is representing the arches, and in human embryo there are six pharyngeal arches, as you know, first, second, third, fourth, fifth and sixth. And all these pharyngeal arches except the fifth pharyngeal arch, they give rise to the muscles and bones of the head and neck region. Besides the arches, we also learned about the pharyngeal clefts. Yes, the pharyngeal clefts, these are the grooves that separate the pharyngeal arches externally. That means they will be lined by the ectoderm. So the blue color grooves separating the arches are the pharyngeal clefts. And on the other hand, just opposite to the cleft, you can see the yellow colored grooves separating the pharyngeal arches from inside. So these are the pharyngeal pouches. So remember, the pharyngeal number of pharyngeal clefts in human embryo is 4, and number of pharyngeal pouches is also 4 in a human embryo. And all the pharyngeal pouches, they give rise to some very important structures of the head and neck region. And as for the cleft, only the first pharyngeal cleft will take part in the formation of some definitive structure in an embryo, whereas the other three, second, third and fourth, it gets obliterated. Now coming to the development of the tongue. It is seen that at fourth week of development, the tongue appears in the region of the pharyngeal gut. The first four pharyngeal arches, so we have all total six pharyngeal arches. Of this, the first four pharyngeal arches, they will contribute to the formation of the tongue in an embryo. Now let us see how the tongue develops from these pharyngeal arches. So if you look at the picture, you will see that the first pharyngeal arch, the region of the first pharyngeal arch that will be forming the tongue, is represented by the orange color. The blue color represents the second pharyngeal arch, yellow color is representing the third, and green color is representing the fourth pharyngeal arch. Now all these four pharyngeal arches, they will take part and form the tongue. So contributions from the first pharyngeal arch is that on the first pharyngeal arch there will appear two lateral swellings. As you can see in the picture, two swellings on either side of the midline are present. These are called lateral lingual swellings. And there is also a midline swelling just behind the lateral lingual swelling. This is called tuberculum impar. So these two swellings, they appear on the first pharyngeal arch. Another midline swelling will appear just behind the tuberculum impar, and this midline swelling will arise from the second, third and part of the fourth pharyngeal arch. As you can see, the second is represented by the blue, then the yellow and then the green. This second midline swelling is known as the copula or hypobronchiate eminence. If you go further behind, you will see another midline swelling arising from the posterior part of the fourth pharyngeal arch. Yes, can you identify? This is called the epiglottal swelling. And remember, this epiglottal swelling in future will form the epiglottis in the embryo. And just behind the epiglottal swelling, you can see a triangular area, black area, that is the larynx orifice of the larynx or the laryngeal inlet rather, which is bounded on either side by the arytenoid cartilage. So these contributions together, they will form the tongue. So what are these? These are the two lateral lingual swellings, then three midline swelling. The first one is the tuberculum impar, second one is the copula or hypobronchial eminence, and the third one is the epiglottal swelling, though the epiglottal swelling will form the epiglottis only, not a part of the tongue it will form. With development, you look at the picture, with development, the two lateral lingual swellings, they overgrow and they fuse in the midline, and also with the tuberculum impar, which you can recognize in the posterior part, to form the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. That means the anterior two-thirds are being represented by the orange color in the picture. So the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, which is also called the body of the tongue, it will develop from the two lateral swelling, fusion of the two lateral swellings and the tuberculum impar. So these three together will fuse to form the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. Now, as for the posterior one-third of the tongue, it is seen that it will arise from the hypobronchial eminence or the copula. So where this hypobronchial eminence was put, it was a midline swelling involving the second, third and part of the fourth pharyngeal arches. So that copula, it will form the posterior one-third of the tongue, and the extreme posterior part of the tongue, as you can see in the picture being represented by the dark green color, so this extreme posterior part of the tongue will develop from the fourth pharyngeal arch along with the epiglottis. If you look at this picture, you will see that the anterior two-third is separated from the posterior one-third of the tongue. That means the orange color and yellow color, they are separated from each other by a V-shaped sulcus. This sulcus is called sulcus terminalis, and the apex of this sulcus, there is a foramen called the foramen cecum. Just remember where the foramen cecum lies, because I shall be using this term foramen cecum when I describe the development of the thyroid gland. So in other words, foramen cecum is found at the junction between the tuberculum impar and the copula. Though many muscles of the tongue, they develop in situ, but some muscles, they arise from the myoblast originating in occipital somite. So this is how the tongue will be developing in an embryo. So when these swellings were fusing with one another to form the tongue, the swellings were adherent to the floor of the pharyngeal gut. That means now it has to separate the tongue after its formation, it has to separate it from the floor of the pharyngeal gut. Now, to separate the tongue, after its formation, there occurs extensive cell degeneration adjacent to the body of the tongue. Okay? So body of the tongue, as you know, it will be formed by fusion of the two lateral lingual swellings and the tuberculum impar. So at the margin, there would be extensive cell degeneration so as to separate the fusion of these so as to separate the developed tongue from the floor of the mouth. And this process of extensive cell degeneration, it frees the sides of the tongue from the floor of the mouth. And the only tissue that normally supports and anchors the tongue to the floor of the mouth is frenulum. This is the normal phenomenon. Only the frenulum would be anchoring the undersurface of the tongue to the floor of the mouth. And as you can see, the frenulum, its normal attachment is that it is attached to the posterior part of the undersurface of the tongue in the midline. This is what happens normally, and this is how the tongue gets separated from the floor of the mouth, and now it is a mobile structure, but it is anchored to the floor of the mouth by the frenulum. Coming to the innervation of the tongue. General sensory innervation to the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, that is being represented by the yellow color. So we have learned that the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, it develops from the first pharyngeal arch. And you already know the nerve of the first pharyngeal arch, don't you? It has got two processes, maxillary process and mandibular process, the first pharyngeal arch. So it is seen that the anterior two-thirds of the tongue is supplied by the mandibular division of the fifth cranial nerve. Now, as for the general sensory innervation of the posterior one-third of the tongue, it is seen that the posterior one-third of the tongue, it is supplied by the glossopharyngeal nerve. But we have learned that the posterior one-third develops from a midline swelling called copula that arises from the second, third and part of the fourth, isn't it? But why then the glossopharyngeal nerve will supply the posterior one-third of the tongue? Why not the facial nerve or the nerve of the fourth pharyngeal arch? Its embryological explanation is that the posterior one-third of the tongue, when it was developing, it is seen that the tissues of the third pharyngeal arch, it grows at a faster rate and it overlaps the tissues of the second pharyngeal arch. That is why most probably the posterior one-third of the tongue is supplied by the glossopharyngeal nerve. And as for the extreme posterior part being represented by the green, dark green color in the picture, it is supplied by the vagus nerve, including the epiglottis, which will be supplied by the branches of the vagus nerve, that is the superior laryngeal nerve. Now, coming to the special sensory innervation of the tongue, that is the nerve concerned with the taste sensation, the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, it is supplied by the chorda tympani branch of the facial nerve, whereas the posterior one-third of the tongue would be supplied by the glossopharyngeal nerve. And as I have already said, the epiglottis and the extreme posterior part, its nerve supply would come from the superior laryngeal branch of the vagus nerve. And as for the nerve supply of the muscles of the tongue, it would be supplied by the hypoglossal nerve. So this completes the development of the tongue, including its nerve supply. Now coming to the development of the thyroid gland. Remember the foramen cecum? Yes, foramen cecum is located at the apex of the sulcus terminalis, as you can see in the picture. Now to form the thyroid gland, what happens? There occurs epithelial proliferation in the floor of the pharynx at foramen cecum. So at the floor of the foramen cecum, the cells, they proliferate to form a mass, and this mass, it is going to form the thyroid gland in the developing embryo. But we know the thyroid gland is not located just behind the tongue in us, is it? That means from the site where it is formed, the thyroid gland will migrate to its final position in front of the neck. So in this picture, you can identify the foramen cecum, you can identify the tongue. Yeah. Now coming to the foramen cecum, I say thyroid gland develops as epithelial proliferation in the floor of the foramen cecum. Now from here, that epithelial mass which is being formed, the future thyroid gland, it migrates downwards. You trace that line. So it will migrate downwards and ultimately it reaches its final position in the front of the neck, just beneath the larynx. You can identify the larynx. You can read the thyroid cartilage. This is the cartilage of the larynx. So that part is the larynx in us. So thyroid gland, it comes and is located just beneath the larynx in an embryo. It is said that the thyroid gland, after being formed at foramen cecum, floor of the foramen cecum, it migrates. This dotted red line indicates the path taken by the thyroid gland to reach its final position in the neck. So they say it reaches its final position at about 7th week of development. Okay, and the thyroid gland, it begins functioning by 12th week of development. So it starts functioning at a very early stage because the hormones secreted by the thyroid gland, they are an essential, they are very much essential for the normal development of the developing embryo. That means by 3rd month of development, the thyroid, it begins to secrete the hormone thyroxine, triiodothyronine, calcitonin. Yes, who will secrete the calcitonin? I said in my previous class, calcitonin would be secreted by the C cells or the parafollicular cells, which come and merge in the parenchyma of the thyroid gland from the ultimobranchial body. Where from the ultimobranchial body developed? It develops from the ventral wing of the foot pharyngeal pouch. Just remember, as the thyroid gland migrates from the foramen cecum to its final position at the root of the neck, just beneath the larynx, during all this time, the thyroid remains connected with the foramen cecum by a narrow canal, and this canal is called the thyroglossal duct. Now, once the thyroid reaches its final position, this thyroglossal duct, it should disappear, but if it persists, then we have a congenital anomalies, which we shall discuss towards the end of this class. So this is how the thyroid gland develops in us. Very wide mouth. As you can see here, this baby, its mouth is too wide. This condition is called macrostomia, and if it is too wide, it needs surgical correction. As you can see in picture 1, it is being surgically corrected. It is macrostomia, very wide mouth. The second condition is just opposite of macrostomia. This is microstomia, when the mouth cavity is too small. And it will also require surgical correction. Now coming to ankyloglossia. To understand ankyloglossia, you must remember about the frenulum. So I told you frenulum is a midline tissue which connects the under surface of the posterior part of the tongue to the floor of the mouth, isn't it? So that is normal. But when the frenulum extends up to the tip of the mouth, thereby making it difficult for normal functioning of the tongue. It will be difficult while eating, and in speech also it will hamper. So that condition, when the frenulum extends up to the tip of the tongue so as to hamper the mobility of the tongue, that is called ankyloglossia. And ankyloglossia, it might require surgical correction. On the other hand, there could be a condition called congenital absence of frenulum. As you can see in the second picture, no frenulum is being formed in this person. So this condition, macroglossia. Macroglossia is the term used for an unusually large tongue. So such a condition can cause cosmetic as well as functional difficulties in speaking, eating, swallowing, sleeping, etc. Now, cause of macroglossia, it could be a large tongue, could be due to infection, it could be due to allergy, or there are many genetic disorders and metabolic diseases where there is development of very large tongue. A also macroglossia would result from trauma, malignancy, etc. As for the treatment of macroglossia, surgery which is called glossectomy may be required to reduce the size of the tongue. This is called microglossia, means the tongue is too small. These pictures you can see very small tongue. Remember, the macroglossia, they say it could be due to formation of too much of tissues of the tongue. So this is a picture showing bifid tongue. Bifid tongue results when the two lateral lingual swellings arising from the first pharyngeal arch, they fail to fuse in the midline, resulting in bifid tongue as seen in the snakes. Now coming to the congenital anomalies of the thyroid gland, there could be aberrant or ectopic thyroid gland. There could be retrosternal thyroid gland. Retrosternal means when the thyroid descends beyond its normal position into the superior mediastinum. Retrosternal thyroid is usually found just behind the sternum. There could be persistence of the pyramidal lobe. There could be agenesis of the isthmus of the thyroid gland. There could be agenesis or hemiagenosis of the thyroid gland. There could be thyroglossal duct cyst and persistence of the thyroglossal duct. So these are some of the congenital anomalies associated with the development of the thyroid gland. Now, these are the sites of ectopic thyroid tissue. So you have learned that the thyroid develops at the floor of the foramen cecum, and from there it migrates, isn't it? So it is not uncommon to find thyroid tissue anywhere along the path of migration of the thyroid gland towards its final position. So we can get thyroid tissue at the level of the foramen cecum, at the tongue, that means, which will be called the lingual thyroid. Then this is suprahyoid, above the hyoid bone. Below the hyoid bone is infrahyoid. Then just in front of the larynx we can get, and that the last one is the normal final position of the thyroid gland. Now this pyramidal lobe of the thyroid gland, it is seen in about 10 to 50% of the population. What it is? I have told you that all the time the thyroid is migrating towards its final position, it remains connected with the foramen cecum by a narrow canal called the thyroglossal duct. Now when the distal part of the thyroglossal duct fails to disappear, it will persist as the pyramidal lobe of the thyroid gland. So it represents the persistence of lower end of the thyroglossal duct. It is often seen as the third lobe of the thyroid gland. Now, what is thyroglossal cyst? It is a fluid-filled cyst in front of the neck, just above the larynx. To understand the thyroglossal cyst, again you have to understand the thyroglossal. You have to remember the thyroglossal duct. So it was a narrow canal. But if the thyroglossal duct it presents with some cystic swelling, which would be in the midline, that is called the thyroglossal cyst. Now, thyroglossal cysts, they are usually painless unless infected, and they are very soft to touch, round in appearance in front of the neck. And how will you diagnose a thyroglossal cyst? Thyroglossal cyst, remember, it typically moves when the person swallows or sticks their tongue out. Why it sticks when the tongue is out? Because it is attached to the foramen cecum. So whenever there is movement of the tongue, the cyst will move, and the treatment is surgical removal. This is yet another picture showing the thyroglossal duct. So it is a midline swelling that moves with the swallowing and sticking out of the tongue. It would be a thyroglossal duct. Had it been a lateral swelling on either side of the neck, what will you doubt? It has to be a cervical cyst or branchial cyst. So this picture is showing where the sites of thyroglossal cyst, where we normally find if the thyroglossal cyst occur, where they should be normally found. So it could be at the level of foramen cecum, that means just behind the tongue. It could be so in suprahyoidine position, infrahyoidine position, and just in front of the thyroid cartilage of the larynx. Okay, these are the normal sites where we find the thyroglossal cyst. It is when the thyroglossal duct fail to disappear and cystic swelling appears. So when the entire thyroglossal duct fails to disappear, it will persist as the thyroglossal duct. This duct, it will connect the foramen cecum to the isthmus of the thyroid gland. Okay? So this is the thyroglossal duct. But normally, in majority of the people, it disappears after the thyroid reaches its final position just beneath the larynx. And if the lower part of the thyroglossal duct persists and the upper part disappears, we call it the pyramidal lobe of the thyroid gland. Thank you.